than I took hours of sleep. So I'm expecting you guys are well awake now. Alright, we have all the sponsors here that are going to, without them, we cannot make this conference happen. Alright, so their generosity of give us to sponsor the conference to cover all the food you guys have, and all the air mattress, and give it to the volunteers, host some of the students being hosted by the MIT students, right? There's a lot of other expenses and all the AV and all the facility cleaning up all those costs. So I thank you for all the sponsor, right, to help us to cover all the costs. Then as a result, we can push your registration fee down because I know that you guys are students, right? Unable to afford $500 or $800 to attend a conference.
This is frozen. This is frozen.
Is it?
Oh, it's actually this one. I had to use this. I know I had to check because this one is.
Okay,
which one?
This one.
All right. So, by the way, I'm Soon Wan. I'm sure you got my email. If not, you can shoot me an email, I can give you more emails. I'm going to announce that you guys should receive an email from Alice, the conference chair, about the voting on the best paper presentation and the poster presentation. All right, please vote. All right. So the lucky, we will have a two drawing of $50 Amazon gift card. Across. So if you vote, you stand a chance to win the gift card. All right, so vote. It's coming up. Oh, don't use this. I had to use this.
Well, while we're getting that up, I'll do a quick intro. My name is Krista McCartney. I am a staff member of the IEEE. I joined in 2005. My background is in technical, so don't ask me technical questions. I have an English degree, an MBA in finance. I stayed at home and raised a couple of little girls, and went back to become an elementary school librarian. And here I am. So the reason I'm here and not in some elementary school is that in order to rebuild a network, I got involved with the professional societies in New Jersey, and it just so happened that both the chairs of those organizations worked for the IEEE. They looked at me differently than I looked at myself and said, we think you'd be good at this particular job. I didn't take it that seriously, but I did the interview, and indeed it wasn't necessarily a good fit because they had me as a liaison with librarians at MIT and Stanford and Caltech, and I had just graduated. What was I going to teach them? But what I told my students, look at your job as an entrepreneurial activity. What's not being done? Look at companies that's not being done. Maybe there's an opportunity for you there. And I focused on students. We weren't doing such a good job in 2005 engaging with students. So my career I've become kind of a student advocate for all that you do and try and support activities that build better engineers, both technically and with soft skills. So when I talk about what are the two most important things, I always used to say network, network, network. Your university will get your first degree, after that it's your network. But there's a step before that. Nobody wants to network with you if you're not competent, and if you're not a lifelong learner, if you're not enthusiastic, if you're not good as a team member, if you can't organize things well and communicate well. So if you're competent, you continue to learn throughout your career. How are you going to do that? Start thinking about that. And if you're well connected. This is a picture from a student meeting I hosted at Microsoft Research back in 2005. And the network, you never know what you learn. You have to stay in touch with the people you meet throughout your life. So on the left, Shani Lee, Columbia chair, now working at Microsoft. Cons is finishing her master's at UCSD. Libby's finishing her master's at Michigan. Behind him, Ronak Nathani, for those of you interested in data science. He works for a company called Insight Data Sciences. They have these cool fellowships, intensive fellowships in data engineering, data science. Libby Pertel is working at a law firm in Palo Alto. Did you know engineers could be hired to become technical advisors at law firms? They prove themselves and the firms send them to law school. You might not have known an opportunity like that existed. Now you do. Two Altera engineers, you'll hear more about them. Savannah Lee, she just got back from Alaska. She's on a committee with IEEE USA, and when they want her to be somewhere, they send her.
lots of opportunities with the organization that you might not know about. And on the far right, Justin is now at Raytheon. He was a UCLA officer. So, real quick, MIT is celebrating their 100th anniversary. We go back to 1884. We've been around a long time. These are some of the founding members of the IEEE. We are a storied organization. We continue to attract highest caliber people to the organization, at least in my opinion. Four areas of business. We are the world's largest technical society, over 400,000 active members in 160 countries around the world. We're divided technically, different societies, robotics and automation, photonics, communications, computer, all people who drill down deeply into a particular area. Geographically, this is the MIT student branch, part of the Boston section, part of Region 1. There are 1,600 to 1,800 IEEE conferences hosted each year. That's a lot of conferences, a lot of opportunities there. Standards developer, we're best known for Wi-Fi. And we publish approximately 30% of the world's technical literature. There are an awful lot of people that are members because they need high-quality, peer-reviewed information in order to build new products and services. Okay. A lot of people think of us as eggheads. Most of your faculty may be either publishing with us, reviewers, authors, conference organizers, fellows, et cetera. And yet, there are more people, more members in industry than anywhere else. Remember that when you go out if you're looking for an industry job. You're going to appreciate me mentioning this.
Thank you.
We've become very big in not just engineering for profit, but engineering to make the world a better place. This is the grandfather of all humanitarian technology conferences. Soon, Rob, Bruce are all heavily involved with that if you have questions. We also have opportunities. We partner with other organizations. Engineering for Change makes critical information to improve the quality of lives around the world freely available. You don't have to pay for it. You can take from it. You can contribute to it. We partner with Engineers Without Borders, ASME, and other organizations. We have a new special interest group in humanitarian technology. Important to you is resources, funding, and leadership opportunity. I talked to some of you who are interested in being an engineer who does good, thus doesn't do well. And I invite you to look into that more carefully. I'm going to cover a tremendous amount of ground. You're not going to remember it all. Business cards, email me. I will follow up, send you the slides, whatever you need. Another one, engineering projects in community service. If you have a need in your community, you want some funding to help you solve that, if you'll help us build a pipeline by engaging high school students, it's win-win-win for everybody. Listening to a 50-plus-year-old woman with no technical background talk about the IEEE is one thing. This is a slide I snagged from Natalia Baklitskaya, who was my Columbia chair. I met her probably back in 2007, and she grew with the IEEE there. The slide she gave at a presentation last week for Young Professionals webinar. So I'm going to talk to her points. These are things that she pulled up that were critical to her career as she built it with the IEEE. And the first thing is, you know, she made her mistakes while she was a student, okay? You're not a good presenter, you're not a good organizer. Be lousy at it when it doesn't matter. It doesn't matter at the student level. Yes, I am the IEEE mom. Stanford gave me that name, I embrace it. But you'll see here the things that matter to her. Friends, there's, you know, friends, projects, mind share. What do you learn from other people like you in other locations with other ways of looking at the world? And also, jobs. I can tell you she went to IBM, went to Qualcomm through an IEEE branch connection to Columbia, then Tech Labs by attending conferences. She's now at Altera. This is my universe. This is why they call me the IEEE mom. Look at what MIT is doing beyond this conference. What's important to different students throughout the country? What's not being done on their campuses that they are contributing to through the branch organization? This is just one thing that MIT is doing. You look at UCLA, they're big on projects. The industry where they are, they want to see kids who can do things, not just think about doing them. Don't have just the mind skills, but the physical, the hands-on practice experience. Same thing with UCSD. They're focusing incredibly heavily on professional skill development because their university doesn't do it at the level the students think they need. Jobs. Isaru was one of my branch chairs at Drexel. You know when people come in and do those tech talks? Do a little research. Have some questions to ask. Be engaged and engaging. Sometimes good things come out of it. He got one of his co-ops out of it. Another Drexel PhD. Why do you go to conferences? Conferences are a conversation starter. You give your presentation, people ask you questions, maybe they know of opportunities for you. He went to a lot of IEEE conferences while doing his PhD, got offered a job offered by Intel, he continues to work, published with us, and here's the cool thing about the IEEE Explore database, which is where the 4 million articles are. Most people give you their email address. You read an article, you have questions, there's nothing that says you can't engage with that person, that you can't reach out to them and say, this is cool, tell me more, or how'd you get here, what's next, what have you done since then? Proof that industry cares about, you being able to do something outside of the classroom, Georgia Tech, Harris Corp, check for $185,000, foundation to the student branch, not to the university, only the student branch can touch the proceeds of that money, because they like the fact that the branch helps students learn outside of the classroom to become kind of the complete engineer that rises up the ranks in any industry. I am not going to do a slide on scholarships. Jenny Hunter, the branch chair there, now at Microsoft. Two of the best known scholarships we give, Power and Energy Society. They give out literally hundreds of them a year. And also the Computer Society Merwin Scholarship. She was a Merwin Scholarship recipient. Professional communities, and keep me on time, okay? Okay, an example of how involvement can help. Frank, branch chair Stanford, went to Broadcom. Every single person he interviewed with was an active member in the Orange County IEEE. So they had something else to talk about than just classroom experience. He became the Computer Society chair, built a network that is pretty extraordinary. Concha, first woman ever to win a Marconi Society Award. I went to the ceremony. They talked about technical, but they talked about leadership because she started Women in Engineering at Stanford. Ask her what were the two most important classes she took in her PhD, technical writing, public speaking, which is why you're here and that's the experience you're getting and it makes a difference. Conferences. Of those 1,800, most are technical. Just as a point of reference, there are 331 IEEE conferences between today and the end of the year around the world. A lot of opportunity. Student conferences. Region 1 will have a student conference in 2017. Most of the regions do have that. Region 6 does something called Rising Stars out in Las Vegas. It feeds right into the Computer Electronics Show. Women in Engineering, International Leadership Conference. This is why you go to a conference. All these companies are there. They're promoting, but they're also recruiting. And gentlemen, this is a picture of Natalia, whose big slide I'm using at her wedding this May. Her husband was the one who got the job going to this conference. Women in Engineering is for everyone who wants to be a better engineer and engage differently with all people. Later in December, you have the Northeast Women in Engineering Forum. You're welcome to join that. They're looking for volunteers. Entrepreneurship conferences. I didn't even know about this one until I came here last year. I ran into this woman, Ana Luisa Santos, who's an MIT grad, did a couple of startups in Brazil, and said, oh, by the way, did you know IEEE has all these entrepreneurship activities going on? We're a big organization, and I can't know everything, but I learned because I got out and talked to people. Talk about becoming a speaker. Just because you're a student doesn't mean that you can't have something to offer. Future Leaders Forum had people like Vince Cerf, Dirk Hendrickson of Coca-Cola Company, chief engineer of HP, and also Jonathan Chu and Leo Cito, two branch chairs out of UCLA. Publications and research, this is our bread and butter. If Concha says it or if Natalia says it, it really is that good. It's a way to find a network of experts. Think about it. We cover anything touched by technology. You go into that database, play around with it. Put in your hobbies as search terms. See what's out there that you didn't even dream of because you don't have the worldwide experience. People publish with us because we're good, highly cited, highly rated. I'm coming to the close because I know we have to pass this on. This is a young woman out of Virginia Tech who was our branch chair, started the Women in Engineering chapter there. How'd you like to have that written about you 6 months after you graduated? What she talks about, Covestro invited to give one of their employees the chance of a lifetime to join the Solar Impulse team. The Solar Impulse was the solar-powered aircraft that went around the world. She got to go halfway around the world because she had developed lucky engineers selected to join. For that reason, I always encourage students to get a set of multidimensional skills that could be part of any career. Not only did she run Women in Engineering at Virginia Tech, she got involved at the Pittsburgh section. She developed a presence. She knows how to speak. She knows how to engage, deal with the public. It made her stand out and gave her really a once-in-a-lifetime opportunity. And Natalia, whose slides I'm using, because she saw me posting about Paige, new Solar Impulse was coming out there, the network does fun stuff too. You know, she got an on-the-ground personalized tour of the Solar Impulse. Pretty much last slide for me, this is my network, 2009. Okay, I meet students sometimes once or twice. I mean, I cover schools all around the globe, literally. I may be there once, they graduate, move on. But if you're building a network, you never really lose touch with people because there's always something that you've enjoyed about them. So 2009, there's a couple of the students in 2013, 14, 15. Dinner with the Golnabis a couple months ago. And the reason I put this up here is I got this on Monday. Chairs from Caltech, MIT, UC San Diego, who ran into each other last weekend at the Carnegie Mellon Rising Stars Conference. They're all now PhD students at different schools, but they recognized each other. You're going to run into each other throughout your careers because you're operating at a higher level, and you want to keep this network, everybody you've met here, everybody you've engaged with, keep that going forward. I'm done. Please vote.
Hi, I'm Larry Rudolph. I work at Chu Sigma, a high-tech hedge fund, just to tell you who I am. I've been an academic most of my life. I work in high-performance parallel processing and supercomputing stuff. I was at MIT on the faculty from 96 to 2006, and I'm still an affiliate, and I'm affiliate at BU and NYU, and I'm at Two Sigma in the labs. Two Sigma is a high-tech hedge fund in New York. There's offices in Houston as well, but it's really high-tech. So just very quickly, when you think about Facebook, you think they're a computer company, or Google is a computer company, or Amazon is a computer company, and the answer is no, right? Amazon used to sell books. Facebook is a media company. Google is an ad company. But they all are major high-tech compute aspects, and Two Sigma is trying to be that as well. And we, I don't know if you can read this, but we look at data, we care about machine learning and high-performance computing and large data sets, and statistics, and we are really sort of pushing the envelope in all these fields. I saw some of your posters today. I could talk a lot about Two Sigma, but I want to just sort of talk at a high level. So I thought what's more interesting is to talk about some of the things that we do at Two Sigma, and that's we try to extract signal from data, and we look at a lot of different data sets using all sorts of techniques, right? Sometimes the signals work, sometimes they don't. And how do we know they work? We simulate. We simulate how they would work. So if you figure out some sort of signal, you'll build a model, and we add the model to our collection of models, run that over the past 15 years of the stock market, and see whether it improves or not. So think about what I just said, right? If we simulate hundreds of models on how they work on all activity on the stock market over the last 15 years, that's a lot of computing. So I looked at your slides. I can talk about the company, but I'd much rather talk about a result. Okay, and I think this is a result that all of you could understand, although it's pretty significant, although it's simple. It's significant because it gives us much better performance. One of the things that we do is we run a
we have a long data stream. Maybe it's the stock market, maybe it's a Twitter feed, or maybe it's some other data set, but often we want to run a sliding window computation. Run the window, do some computation over some part of that long data stream, then slide it over and slide it over and slide it over, and doing the computation all the time. So here you can see the little window sliding over. I didn't do an animation because it's easier to see it this way. Okay. So the window is a size 4. Here's the data. Suppose if you want to do a sum over this window, that's pretty easy. You do the sum over the first part of the window. And then when you slide it over by 1, you subtract off the element that you lost. So we lost the 2. That's not 15 minus, it's 15 equals. So we have 9 from the previous result. We dropped off the 2, and we added in 8. All with me, great. And you get 15. When you slide the window over, we drop off a? Anybody following this? This is not hard. We drop off a 1, and you add a 3, right? And that's adding 2. Pretty easy. Each time you slide over, you just have to do some operation things. You drop off and add in. Great. We've done this for decades. What about when you do things like max? So max doesn't really have an inverse or invertible function. You can't drop off a max, right? So here, in the max of the first window is 4. The next window is 8, and that's great. And it stays 8, 8, 8, 8, 8, until at the end here, we see we drop off the 8, and we added in a 2. But how do we know that the max is 4? We have to scan over that whole window again. With me? If you're not with me, you should start again. Okay. So how do you do this? Well, it means that every time for something like max, as I slide the window, I have to do the computation over the whole window. Doing a computation over 4 cells is easy. We slide windows. We have windows of size 365 days. Over the stock market. And so that's a lot of recomputation during each slide. Okay? So what do you do about that? Well, if you're clever, and you're really clever, you say, well, I'll build a tree over that and maintain the tree. And that's, as you can see in the top left, nice binary tree, and I do the max over that tree. And then when I slide the window, well, some part of that tree falls away, and some part of the tree gets added. So it's not really a great balanced tree. And as you slide the tree, slide the window some more, the tree gets really sort of unbalanced. So every now and then, it gets too unbalanced, you can rebalance it, which is a really fun algorithm about rebalancing trees. Okay, it's fun, hard to get correct, complicated code. But that was the best state of the art not that long ago, like last year. And so that takes W time if you're going to recompute, or W or log W for each time that you slide the window, or things like that, right? So what do you do? Well, although I've been a computer professor for many years, and I'm in the labs team, one of the engineers who had to implement this stuff came up with the following scheme. So we all innovated 2 sigma. So he said the following. He said, let's not compute it one at a time, but let's look at a bunch of windows. All those windows that, say, overlap 2. And so now I have a group of windows. And I'm going to work on those windows. And after I finish that, we can then do the next set. So in this simple case, we're going to look at those 4 windows, right, at the top. And after you finish those, we can move on. With me? OK, so we only want to look at those. Do this thing. We're going to split this windows up into left half and right half. All right? Why am I doing that? Well, I want to compute a function which is associative, but I don't have an inverse. I can always add things together, but I can't subtract things. Or I can compute the max of stuff, but I can't compute the unmax. So this is an interesting picture. Let's zoom in on it for a bit. So I'm going to compute the sum over the left halves of the window and over the right half of the window. Okay? See it? 9, 7, 6, 2, right? Pretty easy. How do you compute this? Well, this part on the right, the 8, 11, 15, is something known as a parallel prefix. compute the 8, that's easy, then add in the 3, and then add in the 4. Okay? So that's one pass over the right data, linearly. Let's go back to the left side. Well, I can't do it the same way, but I can do it from bottom up. And that's the innovation. If you really want to become creative, just look at the world, flip the world, and look at it the other way. Start with the 2, add in the 4, add in the 1, add in the 2. And we get a bunch of these partial results. That's a parallel suffix. Pretty cool? Because now, how do we get the answer? We just need to combine the 2. Right? Put the left half and right half together. So a pass over the right, a pass over the left, and then combine together. Does this work for max? Sure. Actually, it's pretty easy. On the right, 8, 8, and 8, because all the elements we're adding in aren't bigger than 8. And on the left, we start with a 2. 4 is bigger. 1 is smaller, so you keep the 4. 2 is smaller, we keep the 4. Okay. So just combining to show the left and right sides. Once I've computed those on the left, computed those on the right, push those data down into this array, and then just add
even sides. 9 with the 0, the 7 with the 8, 6 with the 11, 2 with the 15. Good, thank you.
And the same thing for the max. Cool? It's a really nice scheme. Linear time, linear space, works for any associative operation, which means that I don't have to talk about a max or a plus, but it's any code that will take two values and be able to do it associatively. So you want to have look at which stock is the max value, or which stock is trending the fastest, or which is correlated with the hem of a skirt, length of a skirt, or something. Whatever that code is. And so very fast algorithm, pretty cool. Pretty much hot off the presses. So I think you can understand it, but you know, that's the kind of stuff that we're doing. You may not think that that's what you do in a hedge fund, but that's what we do at Two Sigma. I'm not going to talk much longer, but this is just part of a very, very big picture. We have 3 data centers or something like 100,000 cores. We have equal amounts inside of Amazon. We have petabytes of data. We talk about if we had more machines, we'd make more money. Which is an interesting aspect. So we need better computer science. So I've been in computer science. I'm happy that Moore's Law ended, because now we don't just wait every 18 months for things to get faster. We have to be smart to get things faster. But we have lots of data, lots of networks, lots of compute. And so we need computer scientists, we need statisticians, but not just traders. You don't need to know about finance to work at Two Sigma. We engage the community. We have open source projects. And just to show you a little bit of what we do, Beaker is like Jupyter. It's a notebook, polyglot notebook. You can run Python and R and MATLAB and Groovy, et cetera. Open source, you can download it today. Not only that, but if you know Jupyter, it's like Jupyter, but if you have a data structure in a Python piece of code, you can then, in the next cell, run R on that same data set. And so you can switch languages as you wish between them. Cook is, we have thousands and thousands of processors, thousands and thousands of jobs. We run on top of Mesos. Cook is an open source scheduler, lets things crash, rerun them, takes care of everything, batch workloads, fair scheduling, and the like. Really hot off the presses is Flint, which is for Spark on time series databases. If you know about Spark, which is the new sort of MapReduce in vogue system for large data, we've modified Spark to work well with time series data, keep things ordered. A few years ago, we did something called ThunderStrike, which figures out how to get a boot kit onto a Mac through the Thunderbolt connector, which is like a it's a full talk. Yeah. It's go listen to Tremel Hudson. He's in the lab. He gave a talk at CCC. You'll really understand how to hack Macs. But, you know, we've done that. because we want to figure out how to protect them. So we're now working on how to get firmware attested and built in so you can have control of your whole machine and no one else. We support the Massachusetts Open Cloud, which is part of MIT, BU, Northeastern, UMass, and Harvard. And it's an open cloud, not a closed cloud like Amazon and Groove and Azure and Google Cloud. Lots of interesting research going on there. And I'm going to finish up by saying we're hiring a lot. We like people who know how to program, whether they be physicists or biologists or people in finance or statisticians or computer scientists. Everyone needs to know how to program, including our receptionists. And if you look at our page, you'll find that. And we also have internships. And it's an internship in New York City, and it's kind of cool. We put you up, and you get to see plays. And we have a great opportunity, and you should apply for that. So if you think about coming for a job, looking for an internship, think about Two Sigma. You should know that we are really a computer high-tech company. So any questions or comments, feel free to email me, and enjoy the rest of the day.
So, with your internships, do you have anything dealing with cybersecurity, or is it just like programming more?
Yes, we have cybersecurity. How to build. So, firmware security now is really turning out to be really hot. If I get your firmware and I corrupt that, this game is over. So, we have a project with the Massachusetts Open Cloud because they do hardware as a service. So, you may rent a machine that someone else had. So, if they corrupted the firmware, you'll never know it. So how do you put that whole slew of attestation from firmware to Pixie boot to BIOS to operating systems? And what are the right schemes for that and to control it? And we're very serious about that, and we have an internship for that. I can, but I think I'm finished.
Hey, good morning, everyone. I hope you enjoyed the conference as much as I did. I was very impressed with the organization of the conference and the quality of the work that you guys did, the posters, presentations, everything was great. We are very happy to get the opportunity to sponsor this conference as the University of Maine, a sponsorship at the gold level here. So I'm just going to talk without any slides. You have already seen too many slides yesterday in my talk. Just want to tell you what do we do at UMaine for undergraduate research. We started a center called Center for Undergraduate Research called Cougar, C-U-G-R, right? So if you go to Facebook, facebook.com/Center for Undergraduate Research, we have YouTube channel, we have Twitter feed, etc. So I wrote a proposal a few years ago. We got $300,000 internal funding from university and state government to support undergraduate research. And our philosophy was that the traditional way of sitting in a class and learning in a lecture is not actually fitting the way that we want to train students today. That's not the way we learn today. When I was an undergrad in the 90s, there were no like YouTube or internet or Netflix or things like that. There was not much online education as we have today. So we are trying to combine online education and experiential learning to create a different environment for the student. So Every year, we have several funding opportunities for students on campus through the academic year and in the summer. And everything is initiated by a student. So you go and find a topic that you like, you go see a faculty member, and we train you through the whole process of writing a proposal, putting your budget together, putting your research question and objectives and methods and timeline and task and everything. And then once you get funded, you work on it. At the end of the year, in April timeframe, we have a student research symposium that a student will come present in terms of posters, oral presentations, or demos. And we feel that they not only learn through the technical aspect of the work when they work with faculty members, they work with graduate students, but also they get the opportunity to present themselves in a professional setting. So the conference that we have at the end of the year used to be at UMaine. It started with like 100 students, and then in every year, we doubled the number of students that were attending. We didn't double, they just come to us, right? So there's no obligation for a student to do this. It's all volunteer activity. And last year, we had thousands of students participate in the conference. We couldn't fit this into university, so we went out to a big stadium outside university in Bangor Cross Insurance Center. So we have had a very fantastic large event over there. So if you're interested to learn more, as I mentioned, we have everything online. If you're interested to work any of the University of Maine research labs, we have so many world-class research going on. You saw some of the works that I presented yesterday funded by NASA, but we also have some of my colleagues who are working in other areas, including like biomedical, computer science, sensor, material science. So we have physics, chemists, electrical engineers, and computer scientists, and so many other disciplines. They all work together in an interdisciplinary format, and we welcome participation from a student. We have several summer programs funded by NASA, National Science Foundation, and the Army. So if you want to come from other schools to work in our research experience for undergraduate programs, just send me a note. My email is very simple. My last name, abedi@ieee.org. We'll pair you with a faculty member to be able to work over there. University of Maine is not really that big. It's kind of medium size. We have 12,000 students, and we hope we can grow from that 1,000 student conference to reach maybe at least half of those students in the campus. And we are 150 years old university. Traditionally teaching university, but in the past 10, 15 years, we moved up from the rankings beyond 300 to now we are in the top 100 tier one research university. So, and that's all because of the effort of a student like you who are creating data as an undergraduate researcher, graduate students who publish in these conferences, and the network that IEEE provided for the student to come and present themselves. So Maine is not just about like Acadia National Park and lobster and nice scenery and forest. So we have very high-tech work going on over there. I encourage you to check out our website, and thanks very much again for the opportunity to talk. So.
Thank you, Ali. Thank you, Ali. As you know, this conference is heavily financially sponsored by IEEE Boston Section. We are very fortunate we have the section chair here, Kelvin. And we also have a young professional chair here. So we will talk a little bit about the Boston Young Professional Activity.
Little side note, I want to talk to you after. I went to University of Maine engineering in the 80s, and I was the last generation to use Heathkit to learn programming languages on the machine language. So I'll talk to you later. So I'd like to say that I'm being environmentally conscious by putting my entire presentation on an iPhone, but what happened was my printer died this morning. So. You're stuck with this. 3.5-inch card, old school. First of all, my name's Kevin Flavin. I'm the 2016 chair of the Boston section of the IEEE. First, I'd like to thank Soon and all the volunteers this morning. I see a couple of them running down with the mics for all the conference, for their excellent work, and soon, especially for your outstanding leadership, success, and the vision for this program. Thank you. When I joined the IEEE as a student at University of Maine, I did not know the difference between the activities of the section and the activities related to a society and an affinity group, and you'll hear about one in a minute. For a moment, let me explain. When you become a member of the IEEE, you're automatically assigned membership to a local region. You may also choose to participate in a special interest of or two or more. The special interests are organized as societies and affinity groups. They have their own organization, and the leaders could span across all continents. The president could be in Korea, the treasurer in Egypt, etc. The local group will have its own leaders that organize the activities and reach out to the local technologists in your interest, holding meetings that feature lecturers of your industry or research focus, or maybe even give the lectures themselves. And these people may or may not be IEEE members. They're just local luminaries. As you participate in the activities, you may eventually step in and lead them. Societies are an excellent way to keep up with the changes of your interests, as well as a fruitful channel to meet the luminaries and knowledge leaders of your space. At a career level, these informal gatherings are a valuable way to network, to find that missing researcher, to make your team complete, or a new employee or colleague, or even a direct manager. The Boston section is the largest section of IEEE. The local societies held more than 130 meetings last year, just in this area. And that's for more than 35 active societies and affinity groups. One group has a standing program that leads a series to help entrepreneurs succeed through education and lectures about all the soft stuff that they don't teach you in engineering, like intellectual property laws and alternative funding sources for your ideas. As a side note, that's how I got back into the IEEE. I used to work for a small software company, and I was part of the investor pitch in my role at the company, because I kind of slid over to sales and marketing, the dark side. So I was better suited to give the presentations. In addition to the societies and affinity group lectures, the section organizes a lecture series of courses for anyone to learn the latest trends, methods, and data, as well as conferences. And we've heard a lot about that this morning, actually. Thank you very much for the excellent presentation. Conferences. The events are also great places to learn, network, and lead. If you just Google IEEE Boston, you'll find the section, the societies and affinity groups, as well as courses, conferences, and other information about IEEE Boston. And on our Facebook page, you'll see this conference. Thank you, Sue. As you progress through your career beyond your studies, whether you're here in Boston or any other location across the globe, you'll always find a local IEEE section to reach out to. Who knows, maybe you'll be the founding member of the Mars section. I certainly hope so. Great, thank you, everyone.
Hi, everybody. I'm Eric Walk. I am the latest chair of the IEEE Young Professionals Affinity Group here in Boston. Show of hands, who's an undergraduate student? Who's planning to graduate someday and have a job and join the workforce? Okay, guess what? When you do, email me. We are the local resource for young professionals. We hold network events, we hold professional development seminars, and other opportunities for young professionals to both meet each other, meet industry leaders, and grow as they are first setting out in their career, and stay connected to the IEEE beyond being a student. So that's the core of what we do. And really, we want to be your first stop when you graduate and help you on your journey beyond. So thank you all for participating, and I really appreciate the opportunity to come talk to you. My email address is eric, E-R-I-C, dot walk, at IEEE.org. Walk. And please be in touch. If you're looking for opportunities, if you're looking for, if you're going to be local and you're looking for a place to meet other people, interact, get to know them, and grow as a professional as well as an engineer, we're here to support you and help you along your journey into professional life.
Do you have a question, Jack?
Question.
Mike's coming. Sir, I'm an international student in America, so I was wondering if IEEE do offer some opportunity for international students there. I'm also an IEEE member, a student member, so I was wondering if IEEE provides opportunity with the international students for studying here.
There's sections all over the world. If you have any trouble finding a home outside of the U.S., I am happy to help.
Thank you so much.